This particular program today with Senator Terri Bonoff, and I'm not going to read her biography because you've got it in your hands, but what I would say is I've gotten to know Senator Bonoff over the last decade or so as part of a lot of the work we do here at the Center for the Study of Politics and Governance. And Senator Bonoff, and I think this would be something that almost everybody at the Capitol would say, is one of the most serious people up there. And I say this as a geek. I think of her as the geek in the legislature, someone that is really willing to dive on issues. One of the topics that Senator Bonoff has worked on for years has been education, really a full span of issues. In some cases, she's taken very courageous issues, controversial issues, such as issues related to tenure. And in other issues, has really been taking a pioneering role. Senator Bonoff and I talked about what issues she wanted to talk about today, and I've asked her to kind of zero in on one issue, not give us a campaign speech, and not talk about a number of issues, but to use this as an opportunity to go in depth, much like Tim Pawlenty used his conversation with us to go in depth about education. And Senator Bonoff is going to be talking to us today about some innovative ideas she's had about higher education. Please give a warm welcome to Senator Terri Bonoff.
Well, thank you so much, Larry, for that introduction and for asking me to join you. And the Humphrey School has really been a partner to legislators and has made it a big difference at the Capitol. I am reminded when I hear you speak of the time we worked on election law. And we spent a whole summer coming here, Republicans and Democrats, looking at what we could do to make some progress in the area of elections. And they facilitated the discussion, and we had people would throw, you know, it was when the whole voter ID subject was being discussed, as well as many issues around the primary timing. And they had a very novel approach. Things that we could agree on, those would go in a green light category. Things we weren't sure about would be yellow. And things that were, you know, really contentious would go red, and we really wouldn't even focus on those. And so I bring that up because my campaign theme since I've been in the legislature has been uniting the middle, and it really comes from a belief that if you can work on issues where most people can agree, you can really get big things done, and then take those things that really there's some agreement on, and you can move that a little forward, and then the stuff that's really contentious, let it go. And so that has been my approach to governing, and I have been so fortunate to be able to have accomplished some really big things at the legislature. So just before I go into that, just a little bit of background, and it isn't a campaign speech, but just to understand what brings me to this point in my life. I am a third generation, third district resident. My grandparents grew up on Lake Minnetonka. My grandpa opened a chain of women's clothing stores in 1946 called Jackson Graves. And then my dad, after he left the Army, he and my mom moved back and went into the family business. And when I finished college, I followed my dad's footsteps and joined the family business. When the family business closed, I went to Tonka Toys, where I did public relations, I did PR, marketing communications, and then finished a 20-year business career at Navarre Corporation, which was also a public company. I was the first woman vice president general manager of one of their divisions. It was their largest division, the computer products division. When I got there, it was $25 million in sales, and when I left, it was over $200 million in sales. So I do bring a broad perspective to my work at the legislature. I bring that business background. By the way, I actually stepped back out of the business world to be home with 14 teenagers. And for anybody who has raised teenagers, you know that it was a gift to be able to be with them, but it was a lot of chaos at my house. So when I went to the Senate, I brought that business perspective with me. And in particular, understanding how important it is, number one, to have a sound strategy to address the challenges that we face. Number two, to be willing to use innovation and creativity to look at what's before us, and then to bring a sense of discipline and order to all that I do. And so I started out working in early childhood, but in the last 4 years, I've been chair of higher ed workforce development. And the first thing that I did as chair is we went around the state and had town hall meetings with students. We had one in this room. We went all over the state. We met with the private schools, Minscu campuses. In I would say 75% of the places we went, and we would just tell students to grab a microphone, and it was really their occasion, whatever they wanted to share. And what they said was shocking, because 75% of the time somebody would start crying when they had the microphone, and they would tell me about the debt they carried, and they'd say they had $50,000 of debt or $75,000, and then they'd say, and they didn't know how they were going to pay it off, and they didn't know what kind of job they were going to have at the end of it. So I had that on the one hand, and then on the other hand, when I became chair, I said to Tom Bacher, majority leader, I don't want to be chair of higher ed, I want to be chair of higher ed workforce development, because I think they're so closely linked. And so we in the Senate, that's how our committee was organized. So I also had this relationship with businesses, and they were telling me they had a skills gap. And they were talking about not being able to fill the jobs, and really they're concerned around the workforce of tomorrow. And so I thought, what a disconnect. You've got all these kids with debt, and yet you've got businesses saying they can't fill the jobs. What is wrong here? And so I tasked my staff and my team to figure out what was working in other places. Where in the world have they solved this challenge? And I would also credit the university, because what we learned was Germany was actually, in my opinion, doing it in a way that I thought held the most promise. They have a system that is called the dual education system. It's where when students are in school, whether it be a one-year program, two-year program, or four-year program, they work for a company at the same time, and they're paid. And so in doing that, they get on-the-job training, they have wages, and then in Germany, their college tuition is covered. And so my staff, you know, pointed me to that. In addition, I had a company in my own district, Bueller, who was bringing that very approach to Plymouth, and they were picking students graduating from high school and doing a deal with Dunwoody, paying for them to go to Dunwoody while they worked at Bueller. So I was beginning to see this in many different places. And then Sabina Engel asked me at the time, she was chairing an area here at the university, she asked me to go on an energy trip to Berlin, and I see Steve Kelly because he was a leader on that trip. I went on that trip, but I had a special focus on the workforce issues and trying to understand the dual education, and then she took another group that just focused on that. And so I became certain that this is something we needed to try. I reached out to the Minnesota Chamber of Commerce, and they assigned their education specialist, Amy Wallstein, to be our partner. And so my staff and Amy spent a whole interim, which interim is, you know, when you're not in session, so they spent the summer and the fall crafting how we could try the German approach in Minnesota. And what we came up with was to do it in an incremental, orderly way, to begin by picking what industries we wanted to try it in, looking at the demanding, you know, growing industries. And so we picked IT, health sciences, and advanced manufacturing. And then we started talking to other folks about it, and my colleagues said, no, you have to add agriculture. So we threw that in too. So we picked four industries, and the first year's legislation said that we would bring businesses, educators, and citizens together, and in these industry sectors or advisory councils, and pick three jobs that we could try this approach in. And so the Department of Labor convened these task force meetings, and we had three or four different task force meetings in each industry. I attended every one of them. And in those meetings, the businesses in particular voted on which three jobs they would try. When they finished that, the other piece of the legislation, so that first year, the legislation just said, you're going to have these advisory councils, the councils would pick three jobs, and then for those jobs, the councils would also come up with the competency standards, because a very important part of the German approach is that industry says you have to learn this, this, and this in order to be competent. And so the Department of Labor also worked with industry experts and those around the table for the three jobs they picked to come up with competency standards. And so we now actually have competency standards established for, I think, 25 different jobs that are now part of this project. So the name, we called this project a name. We spent a lot of time brainstorming what we were going to call it. We called it the Pipeline Project. And we did so because, number one, we're concerned about the pipeline from, you know, the high school through post-secondary. And then it actually has an acronym. So it stands for Private Investment, Public Education, Labor Industry Experience. So that first year, we passed that into law. I had House champions who shared my passion for it. Kim Norton, the very first year, was a leader on that, as well as Marion O'Neill. The second year, we came back and said, okay, now we've got these jobs we're going to try it in. Let's put some money on the table. So the year two put $3 million of grant funding available to businesses, but businesses had to apply for it, and a way to get it, they had to show they were going to hire the student, pay the student for one of those jobs, and then our money went for the tuition. And so right now, we've got over 500 students that have taken us up on that, and they are getting classroom instruction. And by the way, it has to be towards a degree, and whether it be 1-year certificate, 2-year associate degree, or 4-year degree, they're doing that while they're working at a company. So last year, you know, there was now a lot of excitement about this, but I could still tell, and I can tell probably just looking out here, people still don't really know about it, okay? And so what I'm most concerned about are those students who have the despair, who don't see a future for themselves, who don't think I'm meant for college, and they don't know what they're gonna do. And so then I say to my team, okay, how are we gonna spread the word? How are we gonna get to these really at-risk young adults? And so, again, we do research, and we happen to be connected with J.P. Morgan Chase out of New York. Their foundation has invested $750 million into this very space, this area around dual education, because they, too, believe that it holds such promise for the future. So we had a call with them, and they were following our work. By the way, Forbes magazine has written about this project twice. So they knew about our work, and we said, we've got a problem. How are we going to spread the word? How can we reach these communities of color? How can we reach, you know, outstate Minnesota to get these kids that don't have hope as part of this? And they said, well, you should see what's going on in Michigan. In Michigan, there's a group that was made up of software engineers. They were actually aeronautic space engineers, and they left that field, and for 2 years they've been doing research into this very subject of how you can really, on a wide-scale basis, connect students and, you know, people looking for work with companies in a much more sophisticated way. And they developed a software tool that is essentially a match.com. And in Michigan, and this company was called Digerati, they matched in 1 year 24,000 students with engineering internships in just 1 year. So I was like, wow. So we invited them to come to, we had a couple calls with them. We had other people have calls with them. We had the Minnesota Chamber had calls with them. Real-time talent, a public-private partnership that was working in this area. Many people, we introduced them to our concept. We brought them here. They testified in the House and the Senate. There was such widespread excitement about the possibility of using this sophisticated tool to be, in a sense, you have to understand understand, it's completely a blind match. So students fill out a profile about their interests, about their expertise, their hopes, their dreams, the way they like to work, if they like to work individually in groups. In the meantime, businesses fill out a similar kind of profile about what they're looking for in an employee, and then there's an algorithmic match, and essentially for every job, they find seven matches, and they put them together, they interview, and when they come together, these companies don't know if they're interviewing somebody who's of, you know, any particular descent, if a man, woman, religion, and so it's a blind match, and it really levels the playing field and opens the door to a much more diverse set of opportunities for our young people who are most at risk. So we actually presented all this, everybody was excited, we put it into a bill form. We were able to pass in a year when almost nothing passed. We put $400,000 into our bill. It became law. The governor signed it. We gave an RFP to real-time talent because it was a public-private entity. And we didn't say hire Digerati because that's a for-profit company. We said find the best company who could accomplish what we're looking for. And they interviewed many, and they actually did end up hiring Digerati. And Digerati is now at work in Minnesota creating Minnesota-based job placement tool that we can use not just to connect the students who want to try the dual education approach, which I hope we do, but also can be a job placement matching tool for our entire state. And so it was a huge accomplishment, and I share this story for a couple reasons. One, because Larry asked me to pick one policy, and so I did that, but also because as we look at our future, this whole notion of making sure the next generation is educated so that they can be our future leaders is a big challenge. It's a very diverse group that is coming through what I'll call the pipeline. I don't think they have the same family supports that the generation before them had. And so we have to have a different model. We have to have a model that says mom and dad aren't going to get them through every obstacle that's going to come their way when they want to quit or when they're not sure what they want to do. So if we can instead say, but businesses, you've got something at stake here. If you can be that mentor, that support structure to guide our next generation into the workforce, making sure they're equipped to do the jobs that are needed for the future, but that you can also share that blended learning, because our millennial generation is so very smart when it comes to the digital world, and our businesses can use that help. And so it's really a marriage made in heaven. It solves many challenges. It begins to eliminate the debt component, because once kids are being paid and you use state funding to augment the state aid in the Pell, then you really can reduce the expense to kids. In addition, there's a hidden thing, which is now you've got companies who can help put pressure on these colleges to lower their costs. Because if companies have something at stake, they're going to say, no, you shouldn't be ratcheting up your tuition. You should be keeping it at a place where it's sustainable. So I think it really is a win-win-win, and it holds the potential to transform our approach to higher education. It's not for every subject. You know, in Germany and in Sweden, Germany is 65% of the students do this. In Sweden, it's over 75%, but they do it for engineering, for finance, for all sorts of different accounting, many more areas than you would think. It's not just the trades, but certainly the humanities probably won't be part of an approach like this, but it certainly offers us another tool in the toolbox. And before I close, I just, as I'm looking at my regions here, I want you to know that Brian Burr in the ag area has really grabbed onto this. He was in on it from the very beginning. He was part of our advisory council, and so they now do see potential at the university to be a big player in this dual education approach and to be the place where, because in the ag, three jobs, they wanted to study agronomy, herd manager, and we think the University of Minnesota is the perfect place for those students to get their education. So Larry, that's my in-depth policy review, and I always say that, you know, when you really want to get to know a candidate, it's better to find out what they work on and what they're interested in rather than to have them tell you some canned approach to life, because you can learn a lot about what people work on. So thanks.
I described Senator Bonoff as, you know, kind of a geek's geek at the Capitol. I think you can see what I'm talking about.
Now you know what he means.
And also the energy. It's just infectious.
Oh, thanks.
So thank you very much. We do questions here, and we do question cards, and I just want to say the reason is not to weed out questions or topics. The reason is because we try to work closely with the media, and we find that having question cards makes it easier for them, and therefore more likely, that they'll pick up this program and this discussion. So please give me questions. I have a bias towards questions that raise difficult questions and often questions that are dissenting. So please do that. Look forward to it. So I want to just, before we get into some of the, I think, questions about what you propose, just make sure we're all on the same page what you're talking about. It seems as if in the big picture, you're kind of aiming at the sweet spot. Right, because you've got students who feel that they are overburdened by debt, and this has been a big topic this year, and you've got also anxiety about, okay, if I do go to higher education and do put in the money and do graduate, will there be a job that will give me economic security? So that's one side of it. The second side, of course, is the fact that our labor market is, and everyone who kind of looks at this comes to the same conclusion, labor market, it's not just shrinking, but it's not really keeping up with where the economy is going. And so there's a big challenge there as well. And then you've got institutions of higher education, including University of Minnesota, who are searching for what's the model for the 21st century that keeps our classrooms full and remains relevant. Is that the spot you're aiming for? I mean, you didn't really kind of lay that out, but is that the sweet spot here?
That is the sweet spot. I thought I'd laid it out, but I'm glad you are clarifying that. Yeah, when I first became chair, we had three overarching goals for our higher ed committee, and the way we approached our committee is we had a leadership team. So I worked with Jeremy Miller, who was my lead Republican on the committee, and Greg Clausen, and we said that our three goals were reduce debt for students, prepare the 21st century workforce, and increase degree completion. And so we did feel as though introducing this dual education approach, number one, reduced the debt, number two, it did prepare the workforce of tomorrow, and it increases completion, because when somebody sees the relevance of finishing, then they're more likely to finish.
So this, what you've just laid out is obviously an enormous agenda. And the kind of money and scope you've talked about so far is pretty small in the
yes.
scope of things. So how is it that your committee's work and what's passed has significance for this bigger sweet spot that you're aiming for? It seems kind of out of proportion.
Yep. So if you think about it, number one, the companies are paying the kids, so there's no state investment needed there. Number two, we started off by offering up this pool of money to give incentives for companies to participate, to say, if you'll pay them, we'll help offset the tuition. I don't even think it's actually necessary, because I think that the model works either way, whether or not you've got a big state investment or not. Now, having said that, I think it works better when you can invest as a state. And so, number one, the Department of Labor has taken this project and run with it, and they've applied for grant funding at the federal level, and they have been awarded, I believe it's an additional $5 million. Beth, Sean, yeah, just because of this pipeline project. So it's augmenting our $3 million, now it's up to $8 million. But as you know, I'm running for Congress. It's my intention to have this be a national model. When I tell you that JPMorgan Chase wants to invest is investing $750 million in this space, it's because real thinkers believe that this does hold promise and potential for transforming the way we approach higher education. So yes, it was a beginning, but it's a beginning to whet the appetite, and then hopefully when people see its promise, they'll run with it. In addition, as I said, the real concern was getting the word out, and this software tool, I think, is going to go a long way to making it scaled up.
You have not used the word that I thought maybe you would, apprentice. Is this an apprenticeship program?
Yeah, so the reason I don't use that word and I use dual education instead is because there's very specific laws around apprenticeship, and it's very confining. And so if we want this to be a much broader approach where it's not just the traditional trades, and we want companies to think about using this to hire their IT specialist and their next person in their accounting department, we want it to make sure that there aren't regulations and strings attached that narrow their potential to use this approach. And so that's why we keep calling it dual education. It is exactly like an apprenticeship model, but again, we don't want to be boxed into federal laws around apprenticeships. And currently, the unions use apprenticeships in the trades, and they've actually asked me if I would stay out of that arena. And they felt as though they were doing a great job with their apprenticeships, and that they didn't want to have government interfering with their ability to continue doing it in their fashion. And so we had kind of a truce. They said they would be supportive of my work from arm's length, but if I would just make sure I didn't go into their arena.
So just to make this as concrete as possible, the apprenticeship programs, for instance, in carpentry or plumbing.
Exactly.
That's not the space you're in.
Right.
You're going in a different direction. And what direction is that? Are you heading? I mean, what's outside of that that you kind of targeted?
Yeah, so all of the IT sector, this is a perfect approach to train people in IT positions. All of the financial sector, that's why JP Morgan Chase is so interested in it. You know, whether it's accounting, whether it's an analyst, whether it's even supply chain management, all of those. Really, the only ones where this probably isn't the best approach is more humanities and the arts. Although you could certainly use it in theater, couldn't you? You know, you could have, you could see things like that. So I think the sky's the limit, and really the imagination is the only barrier between how you use it and how you don't, other than my commitment to the trades that I was going to stay out of their space.
So you mentioned Germany as a model, and it's quite an impressive record, and as you've said, it's quite dominant. But often in America, we look to Europe, we see things maybe that are admirable. You know, for instance, a single-payer healthcare system or national healthcare, you might say, oh, they've got lower healthcare costs and they cover everybody. And there's been lots of arguments. Now, you're singling out the German model, and I'm wondering if you've wrestled with how you kind of cross the Atlantic on that. You know, for instance, in America, we've tended to have a more, a system that relies and emphasizes the individual freedom and liberty, whether it's the student deciding where to go on their own, the teacher deciding what it is they're going to teach, the institution deciding what it is, you know, they're going to set themselves up as. And in Germany, you've got a system that, where the individual student is tracked from, I think, the eighth grade. And they're moved into a vocational track, or they're allowed to go on the academic track.
Yeah.
How do you think about that, that kind of cross-cultural divide, and whether this is too much for America?
Yeah, and some people even say to me, shh, you shouldn't say you're modeling it after Germany, because of that very concern that we would start, quote, tracking our kids. We do not believe in America that we should track students. We believe that students should have as much choice as possible, the freedom to explore, to innovate. And so historically, we haven't really begun to help them pick a field until they get to college. And then we say, what do you want to major in? And the number one major, undecided, okay? Well, that's a costly, costly system. That's a lot of debt for kids who don't know what they're going to do. And so now you've got a whole generation where our college debt is greater than our credit card debt. You know, they taught those of us who the baby boom generation, somewhere along the way, we figured out not to have credit card debt. We had to pay as we go whenever possible. But look what we've done to these kids. So I think we have to have a balance, Larry, and so you're raising the right question. I don't believe in tracking kids from the eighth grade, but I think we have to do a better job of bringing these potential industries and fields into the high school starting, you know, ninth, eighth grade as just opportunities so they can begin learning about them, developing interests. I'm very proud in Minnetonka, where my kids went to Hopkins, even though we live in Minnetonka, but the Minnetonka School District has this program called the Vantage Program. And those kids, and Regent Devine actually is in that school district area, I believe, but those kids have an opportunity to work at companies while they're still in high school. And I think Bloomington is doing some things like that. There's an effort up in Blaine that does that. I think we do have to do a better job of introducing our students earlier so that they can make better choices, so that they don't have the burden of debt and nowhere to go. The other thing I would say about that is I read an editorial recently. They were opposing both the Clinton-Sanders plan of free college, and they were saying, yeah, well, if it's free, it's not free. It's the taxpayers are paying for it. And this particular editorial said, and if the taxpayers are paying for it, then they better darn well be getting a degree that is going to be meaningful to me. Did you read that one?
Right here.
Yeah. And I thought to myself, that's kind of what I'm saying. Yeah. Like, okay, we'll help offset that tuition, but we'll offset the tuition for a job that we know there's high demand for and that you're going to have a place to go afterwards. And so I think you are raising the elephant in the room question, but I don't think we have to go all the way there. I think there is that middle ground, and we're in the right place.
Let me just repeat this was an editorial in the Star Tribune. It's on a slightly different topic from this, but the title of it is Free College, Then Taxpayers Decide What Kids Study. And in this editorial or op-ed, it said, if taxpayers are to bear the cost, shouldn't they have a say in how their money is used? And of course, this is a very common question about the use of government money. When the government money goes somewhere, then you want to know it's either about accountability or following the intent of the law. And you know, I think you know, at a time when trust in government is at an all-time low, when there's a sense that the government is really ponying up for the special interest, you have a very benign, well-meaning use of these dollars. But I could certainly imagine an argument, perhaps even by a libertarian, who would turn and say, wait, this is very coercive. You're using government money to, you know, really kind of strong-arm students in a particular direction for well-intentioned reasons, but it's going to impair or restrict their freedom.
Yeah, so certainly nobody has to. I think this is an opportunity for students to consider a way to go to school where they get more financial help and they get that support and mentorship that comes from the relationship with industry, and they have a sense of peace around where they'll end up when it's all over. I do have a great relationship with Renee Steiner, the CEO of Bueller North America, and I had lunch with them recently, and they've had tremendous success with the students they've put through this program. They've now got three cohorts, each of five. So the first two have graduated, and those kids who are in the Bueller program, they don't feel coerced. Bueller is actually paying for them to go to Dunwoody for 3 years while they're getting that on-the-job training, and when they're done, they have $50,000 a year jobs, and they're loving it. I went to the graduation, and the parents were there, the grandparents were there, and then the second group graduated, and they're now working there, and the third group will graduate in the coming year. And so I would not be for any program where students had to participate, but I think giving them the opportunity to see that there is another way. And, you know, this free college thing, the thing that bothers me about that is that that doesn't address completion. You know, MinSCU is much less expensive than the University of Minnesota, yet look at the graduation rates at the University of Minnesota compared to MinSCU. And then you realize it's not about cost. There's many different factors that go into completion. And so I think the idea of just, oh, we're going to have it be free, and then, oh, the world's going to work out, I don't buy that.
Well, let me ask you a related question. I kind of was putting forward what I think might be a libertarian objection about freedom. But I can imagine a progressive who would say, well, this is a fine proposal, but really at the end of the day, what you're doing is you may be creating a system in which it's the affluent who have the option of going on in poetry or gender studies, which is what this op-ed was saying we can't afford, whereas the middle income and less affluent are the ones who kind of are have their arm twisted into going in a vocational direction.
Yeah, so that's why, you know, in our committee, when we have performance metrics where we say the amount of money we're going to give the University of Minnesota, we're going to hold back 5% of that money, and then we're going to have goals, and they have to hit those goals in order to get that 5%. And one of those goals is to increase the number of kids of color who go to their schools, increase the number of low-income kids who go to those schools. We have to up our investment in the potential. I mean, I believe every student should have the right to pursue a life that allows them to live up to their promise. And so I don't want it to just be those who are affluent get to be on that track. I want to reach out, I want to dig deep and find out who in every classroom are those who are meant to be our architects or those who have a passion for this and those who want to be a writer. And I want to make sure those doors are open. So it's really about leveling opportunity. And that's why I brought up that software tool, because that's a way that you get to level the opportunity in the playing field. And that's why, for example, I supported the early childhood scholarships when I first got to the legislature, letting low-income families have the same choices for high-quality education that people of means have.
That actually, you're anticipating a lot of my questions, which is a good sign. My understanding is that Edson High School in Minneapolis looked at this model and passed on it. And one of the objections, as I understand it, was the sense that, yeah, we could adopt this, but would this end up, again, perhaps inadvertently, without intention, being a way in which people of color and students of color are diverted from a four-year college track into a more vocational apprenticeship track?
Yeah, well, I think, as I said, we certainly should offer everyone that opportunity, and you've got College Possible in those schools, and I think they're doing a good job, and others like them, the Wallen Foundation, of mentoring students to sit down and figure out what are their interests, what are their tracks, and then opening doors to make sure they can go down those. But there's too many students who think that it's that there's only prestige and the potential for a good life with a four-year degree. And that's just frankly not right. And so we have to do a better job of having families think that there's nothing wrong with a one-year or a two-year degree. Some of the, you know, really high-paying, highly skilled jobs like in robotics don't take 4 years, but that's something that's desperately needed. In the medical field, phlebotomy, where that means they're going to take blood. There's a real shortage of that, and those are high-paying jobs. So I think we do a disservice when you even seem to, Larry, have a prejudice that a, quote, four-year degree is somehow better. I don't think it is better. I think it's different.
I've got a number of questions I've been filtering in, some of them. Here's one. I think it's a kind of a Me Too question. Renewable energy like wind and solar has created thousands of new good-paying jobs in Minnesota. Can the pipeline program help in this industry?
Absolutely. Those would be perfect jobs for the pipeline project. And we started in those four sectors, but the Department of Labor, within the way the law was written, has the capacity and the ability to go beyond that. The only criteria is they have to be jobs that you can come up with the competency standards, and then it's fair game. And within that, the energy sector, you could have the IT folks right now would qualify, but that would be a perfect use of the pipeline project, really bringing the next generation into this economy. You know, we're so concerned about what's happening on the range, and they're saying, you know, we have to have mining for jobs, and some of us have stepped back and say, no, we want to have, you know, new technology startup companies on the range. We want renewable energy companies to be on the range.
Another question from the audience. If Secretary Clinton were elected president and you were elected, how would you approach her idea of a tuition-free public higher education?
Well, I think you heard. I'm not in her camp. Now, just because I don't think it's the best use of our resources, I don't think that it will accomplish what she thinks it will accomplish. Now, we are testing it right now. So Leroy Stumpf, who was the chair of K-12 for many years, really believes strongly that two-year college should, for the trades, should be free, because back in the day, those trades were in high school, and Steve remembers that when technical education was part of the high school. And so we did a test for 2 years for the trades in Minnesota, and for some reason, the word has not gotten out very well, but those students can go to those trades programs for free for 2 years. And so the idea is, let's look at that experiment, let's see what the graduation rates look like, let's see what the job placement looks like, and then we'll come back and look at it. If the data shows me that, in fact, this is a good way to spend our money, then I'm open to it. I've actually seen research that shows the opposite, so I'm not yet convinced. I'd be interested in what the audience thinks about that, but go ahead.
I'm channeling the audience.
Okay.
If the idea of dual education is such a good idea, why haven't more companies followed the lead of Bueller?
It's new. It's novel. You know, we have this weird thing in part of our culture, our competitive spirit, well, that's kind of the best of us. And I admit I've got that spirit in me, and sometimes it's annoying. People say I'm so competitive. That is part of, you know, the capitalism, the structure that we've created. And so companies will say that they're concerned that they'll train this person and then they'll go off to somebody else. Like, how do we know that person will be loyal? And there's a lack of trust about investing in a way, because the track record of, particularly right now, millennials, is they only stay a year or two. And so there's a whole different model and structure that companies are feeling their way, and students are feeling their way. Some have really jumped in, though, I will tell you. Fairview, they've taken full advantage of this. Now the Minute, our department, they're trying it. So we have, I believe, 200 companies that have tried it. So it's new. We think word will spread. Bueller tells us, because Renee speaks to a lot of other companies, he's trying to get others to partner. The more companies do it, the better it's going to work. And he tells them that actually these kids will stay, you know, that they find kids don't leave.
So we often hear from employers, and there have been so many reports on this, it's getting a little tiresome, that we're facing a shortage in the workforce. And this is not a mystery. It's not been a mystery for a long time. But I'm just wondering, is your comment back to the business community when you hear about workforce shortages, it's up to you? If you're really concerned about this, don't sit back, but actually look at creating these dual education programs.
Well, my comment is this Digirati tool. Part of what our state money is going to go for is for them to go out with chamber as partners and the business partnership to go into those companies and get them to sign on and put their potential jobs in the system. And then at the same time, we will take the software tool and go into, you know, MinSCU, go into the high schools and start getting the profiles of those kids, and so that we can begin to do a match. I don't say it's up to you. I say we've got to give you 21st century tools. In the past, it was about who you knew. You know, oh, well, so-and-so's son is looking for a job. Call so-and-so. You know, that's just not going to work in today's environment. And so I don't think that we've got tomorrow's technology and tomorrow's tools yet in place, but we're putting them out there, and I think we are going to solve for it. And Minnesota, we are a leader. That's why Forbes has written about this twice. We are the first state to tackle this on a state level. There are clusters of it all over the country. So in North Carolina, Siemens Manufacturing is working with colleges. There's in Southwest Minnesota, there's been a cooperative effort working with high schools. There's places and pockets all over the country where they're trying this, but it's the first state that has used legislation and a statewide perspective to address this. And in Congress, I'll take it to a bigger level and have a national perspective to address it.
There are a number of questions here that I would describe as really focused on transforming the system of education. And the first set I'll just raise about higher education, and one question asked what the role of the university is in dual education if your focus is not on four-year schools.
Yeah, so it's not on four-year schools. So in the IT arena, you have some jobs that are one-year job, you know, you just need a certificate for, some that are two, but there's many jobs in IT and in finance that need a four-year degree. I want the Carlson School to be part of this. I think the university can play a critical role. They too can be a provider of education to these students who are getting, you know, who go to Target, say, and Target hires them to be their next analyst. They can be working at Target while they're getting their degree, and the University of Minnesota can play a big role and a leadership role in this arena. And I've been introducing this to many folks at the U, and I'm now thrilled that ag is, seems to be the first area at the university that's bid on it, and they're going to run with it.
Now, as I understand the model that you've laid out, it involves getting a kind of a consensus from business on what skill sets they need.
And curriculum.
And then...
See, now he's worried.
Well, and then the kind of falls to the higher education, the local college, the higher education program, to turn around and then tailor the classes, curriculum that's being offered to meet that identified business need. Is that right?
That's correct. And so it's not that the businesses will say, you know, they're going to control every part of the studies, but they're going to say that if you're going to be able to be, you know, a senior analyst, you need to have mastered, you know, this level of statistics, this level of this. They're going to tell, and then the University of Minnesota, they're still going to say, well, but to have a degree from the University of Minnesota, you've also got to have a well-balanced this, or, you know, there's going to be a give and take. But now, that's what I'm saying, now you've got another kind of a three-legged stool, whereas before you just had the students kind of up against the machine, the bureaucracy of education, and the families felt like they were at, you know, kind of the brunt of whatever higher education said was required. Now businesses are get a seat at that table to say, we're your partner, let's figure this out together. So it is an entirely different model, and it's not going to happen overnight, but if we're willing to try it, and one of the only things that kind of had me question, should I leave the Minnesota Senate now, was I don't want this in its infancy to get left aside. I want people to still run with this. But I believe they will. The Department of Labor and the Office of Higher Ed, they're very excited about it. We just need to make sure we have legislative champions that will continue.
So I'm sympathetic, to be candid, with a lot of what you've talking about. I've studied the European model for years, and you know, if you're interested in the debates about economic inequality, one element, kind of a subchapter of that debate, is that in Europe, there has been this effort to track the training of workers as they come into the workplace, so that their skill set matches the job. And those of you who know the debate over what's known as education premium, it tends to be lower in Europe. So I'm sympathetic. On the other hand, I could imagine entirely well-intentioned professors and faculty looking at recommendations from business and saying, yeah, this is a short-term need in this industry. It's for today and the next 3 years, but our students need to really not focus on that immediate set of skills, but rather a much broader set of skills that'll last them for a lifetime. And, you know, again, without getting into charges about bureaucracy or being unwilling to change, don't you think there's a legitimate tension here between the need and demand of business for do it now for our workers and the kind of workshop, the floor plan we have now versus a longer term perspective in the educational institutions?
Yeah. So for a certificate program is really about getting specific skills and abilities for an immediate output, right? So that one, I say there's no issue. A two-year degree, It's a little broader, but essentially it really is, you know, a building block of sorts, and there's jobs and you can make good wages, but again, it's a little bit different. Once you're talking about a four-year degree, then I think the university and, you know, those who deliver four-year degrees, they believe that you've got to make sure you're also instilling the ability to think outside the short term, and creativity is part of it, and analysis. And so Target isn't going to want to have somebody who's on a four-year track with the university and they're paying them to just be, you know, putting the X in the box. They want those skilled thinkers, and that's why they're going to pick the University of Minnesota to be their education partner, because they know that you're going to take care of that intellectual ability.
And that's not happening today?
Well, Target now doesn't have any stake in it. Now they're just waiting for you to deliver those kids, and then they hire them. But they weren't paying them along the way. They weren't giving them the on-the-job training along the way. So I'm asking businesses to step up and have some stake in this, to take on part of the cost. You know, somebody's got to pay the cost. So if the kids can get their on-the-job training and wages while they're getting their degree, that takes a certain amount of the overall cost. If you look at what the Pell goes for in the state aid, all those living expenses that get covered in there, now the taxpayer is not going to be paying them. The business is going to shoulder that.
So this is very helpful, and I think, in filling out this idea of how the current higher education system fits with the new model you're talking about. Let me just shift gears over to Minsky, because one of the big changes in Minsky, of course, was to fold the technical college into the state colleges. Doesn't that present a hurdle for the kind of model you're talking about, particularly with regards to the certificate programs or the two-year technical training?
Well, I think it's distinct, and they each have a different function. Right now, we've got some real challenges at Minsky. You know, I'm an outcome-based person when it comes to investments, and I call Minsky to the table, and I say, look at these graduation rates. What are we going to do about that? This is a very serious issue. And they say, well, we're not the university. You know, we take everyone, and a lot of folks are, you know, have two and three jobs at the same time. But those aren't good investments. It's not good for a student to take on debt and not finish a degree not have a job after.
Let me come back to the question. Do you think we should reorganize Minsky and pull out the technical colleges?
I can't tell you that. I'm telling you that I think each unit, each school should be able to stand on its own two feet, and that we shouldn't just amortize the cost among the whole system and allow some, whether it be a two-year program or a four-year program, if they're not pulling their own weight and if they're not delivering the kind of outcomes that we know serve students, then I don't think they should be allowed to continue. What was that noise?
It was a chirping. We have very loud crickets in here.
I thought it was because I said something so controversial that it chirped.
So we have a question here, another question from the audience. You chaired higher education at a time when the state had multi-billion dollar surplus, yet the university appropriation of Minsky grew at record numbers. How will you get things done in Congress if we've not yet achieved the kind of graduation rates and the kind of progress that you've been pushing for?
Well, I think we have achieved tremendous progress over the 4 years. The university's graduation rate is actually way far beyond where it was when I first became chair. I don't take credit for that. I think that we've raised the conversation by, you know, having the fact that we have hearing after hearing after hearing about it. I think that's important, but I think the regents understand that's important. President Kaler understands that that's important. And so I think we have made great progress. I don't think we've made the same progress at Minsky. I went to this conference that Complete College America put on, and there's real research around what works to increase those graduation rates, and I've urged those folks at Minsky to consider some of those ways. One is like a guided pathway system where there is a much more agreed upon universal curriculum and the transfer pathways. We put laws in place requiring Minsku to do a better job of accepting the transfers. I mean, there's some real problems. So how would I get things done in Congress? I have a broad understanding. As you said, I'm kind of a geek, and I would bring that understanding to tackle these big challenges, and I would build consensus around approaches to do that. I would learn from my colleagues. Amy Klobuchar has already introduced, she's drafted legislation to mirror the pipeline project. She sent it over to our office, and she's introducing it. So I'd have partners in Congress. Al Franken's interested in this.
Seems like they're for one party. Well, anyway, we'll get to that
later. I work with both sides. You know, when the House flipped, then I found a wonderful chief author in Marion O'Neill, and she has been my partner every step of the way. Before the Democrats, when they were in control, Kim Norton was. But as soon as that, I understand. And so this has been a very bipartisan effort. Senator Senjum, every time he sees me, he says, pipeline, pipeline. So he's one of the biggest champions.
We've been talking about transformation of the education system vis-a-vis the pipeline program that you've been talking about. We talked about the university, Minsku. Let's go earlier in the education process. And listening you talk about dual education and thinking about the system in Europe, what's the relevance of high schools in America if your model were to blossom and be kind of scaled up?
Well, that does beg the question about where should the VOTEC be housed? Should it be in high schools, or should we, you know, rather than say, oh, we should move it all back in, we know the tremendous success PSEO has had, and we have the most robust PSEO programs in the country. We have more students participating in post-secondary enrollment options whereby they're either, you know, college in the school where they do it in their high school, or they're going to a college campus. I think we could see a stronger connection, so allowing these students in high school to gain more college credits. And we have to do a better job of sharing the money, because the big barrier we have right now to schools wanting to send their kids over to these universities and the trade schools to get that training is that the money goes with the kids. And so then the high schools are like, no way, I want to keep them. But it's best for the students to let them get those generals and some of that trade exposure early. And so I do think there can be a blurring of the boundary between high school and college even greater.
There are a few questions here that are political.
Sure, I welcome them.
I feel very proud that we've held them off for nearly our entire time together. And I'm not going to get into the full set, but I did want to ask you about one line of the questions, which has to do with some of the ideas you've thought about at the legislature vis-a-vis cities and municipalities in Minnesota, because this is a general question at its roots. As you know, there's a debate in Minneapolis about adopting a $15 an hour wage. There's also been action by the city council to adopt a paid sick leave policy. As a legislator, would you allow Minneapolis to move ahead with those programs, or do you feel like these are issues that have such relevance to the state that they should be preempted and Minneapolis should be barred from doing that?
So that's a state senator question. Certainly you can see how I think, but that was something that was before the state senate, and I'm a co-author of the preemption bill. And so I did not think that Minneapolis should take that action. I don't think that it's good for the overall Twin Cities market to have one city with a set wage that is different than what we have established as a state. We just passed the minimum wage, and many companies, the increased minimum wage, many companies were very concerned that there would be an unintended consequence at this new higher wage, and we haven't even begun to see the data of how that's turned out. And so I think that my preference was to step back and let this roll out and see how it's going for the companies, for the employees, rather than I know that those people on the city council, I'm sure, are watching what's happening in Seattle and in some of the other metro areas that we liken ourselves to, and they say, we want to follow suit. But we, you know, we are a very cold climate, and we're a cohesive Twin Cities market. We really aren't organized as city versus suburbs, for example. So much of the workforce, you know, goes between cities, and it's very complicated when you establish laws with those kinds of boundaries.
So just to put a fine point on this, do you oppose $15 an hour in Minneapolis?
Yes.
Okay. And I think the broader point...
I don't think that the city should determine that. I think that that really there's many factors that go into those decisions, and different industries have different models, and it's complicated. I had a 20-year career in business. I was an executive, and so I just...
So going back to this issue about preemption...
A values statement, though, if I may.
Of course.
I believe nobody who's working full-time should be living in poverty, and that we need to do all we can to make sure that all who are working make a living wage.
Just to get back to the preemption issue, it was an issue in Minnesota in the state Senate vis-a-vis the relationship between state government and city government. Is there a parallel to the national level and the idea of federalism? If you were elected Congress, would you have a preference for national law over state law?
No, because, for example, you know, there's talk about a federal new higher wage, and I think you can't compare, you know, industry in Des Moines to Manhattan, and that there are so many distinctions geographically, and every area's kind of got its own personality and its own culture, and so I would be more of the mindset that states should be free to do what's in their best interests, and whenever possible, that states and regulatory approach have a very light touch, and that we allow those who are providing the jobs to work in a collaborative and cooperative way with those who work for them.
So just to take another issue, you mentioned minimum wage, but you know, there's been quite a bit of debate about labeling, and we have seen states like Vermont creating labeling with regards to genetically modified organisms, and there's been a debate as to whether, you know, the labeling ought to be left to the states for just the reasons you've talked about, or there ought to be a national law that preempts the states from taking action. How do you think about that
issue?
Well,
that actually got settled. There, you know, there is now Congress passed something with regard to how to label, and you know, GMO has this bad rap, but it doesn't. GMO isn't necessarily bad. You know, there are some modifications that are really important to make sure we can feed the planet, and the United States has an obligation to help do that. And so, I know companies like General Mills and Cargill are very active in making sure that they can use technology to expand our ability to help provide food.
But just to get to the issue of preemption.
Yeah, so the issue of preemption. So I was raised in the product marketing arena, Tonka Toys, okay? So we would do packaging for our toys, and we had to have certain packaging if we were going to ship the product to Europe, and other packaging for the States, and because EU standards versus United States. We all said, wouldn't it be better if the states complied with the EU standards, because then we wouldn't have two different kind of packaging. So I think it's easier when you're talking about broad-scale distribution channels that you do have one standard. I don't think it's smart to have a patchwork of standards when it comes to distributing goods across our country. We have interstate commerce. We have global commerce. The more we can standardize those types of things, the less expensive it is for the consumer, ultimately.
Last question, I just received it. What role should the federal government play, if any, in addressing the real or perceived racial disparities in police stops and shootings?
Number one, we've got to do something about gun violence. So the common thread in every discussion, whether it be these, you know, tragic, senseless killings when we as the public see something on TV and it looks like somebody was shot and didn't deserve to be shot, or, you know, what happened in Dallas when those police officers were shot. The common thread is gun violence. Congress has not been willing to be courageous and not oppose the NRA. I am going to be political for a minute here, because my own congressman has voted over 20 times just in the recent times to not bring up gun violence prevention laws. And he stands with the NRA and his party on that. And so I think the public really wants this stopped. The public is very frightened about the amount of gun violence we have in our communities. So that's one side of things. And I say universal background checks, people who, you know, shouldn't have access to guns shouldn't be allowed, whether it's the no-fly, no-buy, people on a terror watch list, somebody who's dangerously mentally ill.
But just
ill.
To get back to the question about
The federal role
with regard...
Yeah, so we should pass gun violence prevention laws.
But the criminal justice system and whether there's...
Yeah, prison reform. We should have tremendous focus on prison reform.
What about this pattern, though? We've seen it in Minneapolis with Jamar Clark, and there was obviously enormous protest. We saw it in Ferguson, Missouri. Is there a role there for the federal government, or is this something that really ought to be left to the states and the cities to wrestle with?
Andy Luger, our U.S. attorney, has played a leadership role in working with community leaders, in having community conversations. I, for example, was a co-author on a bill to support an organization called Kajug that was focused on after-school activities in communities that were at risk of terror recruitment efforts. I think it's an all-hands-on-deck approach, that we have to establish trust between the law enforcement communities and the communities where the violence is reigning and the trust is torn apart there. I think we can help at the state level by passing laws around like body cams so that you begin to have data that rebuilds trust. You know, my pipeline program, if we can, using my new digital matchmaking tool, begin to have people see hope where they didn't see any in terms of their future, and then have the federal government invest in these communities in a targeted way so that it's about hope and opportunity and access to high-quality education. It always comes back to there. Poverty, you know, prison reform. We've got to get those dads back at home instead of in jail for low-level crimes, low-level drug crimes. That's not okay. So I can't give you a soundbite because these are complicated issues, but believe me, there's a role for everybody. Everybody in this room, there's a role for you.
Well, let me just ask a final question, promise. Mark Dayton came out after the most recent shooting. He said he thought that the shooting demonstrated to him or revealed a racist pattern. Do you think it's premature to describe police conduct as racist?
I think in such a highly charged environment that I understand why he said it, because he was struck with the emotion of watching what you watch, and to the observer's eye, that's what it looked like. But then we always know there's what you don't see. And so I know I ask myself to just stop and to try and think, but I don't always do it. You know, I'm a passionate person. Sometimes it's out my mouth. So,
well, I think we've all seen the passion and the energy that you bring to the work you do, and I want to thank you very much for visiting with us today and all the work that you've done. Please give a warm welcome and thanks to Terri Bonoff.
Thank you for hosting me.